zone, but pushing through to the threshold. So it could very well be their first priority, but this map has unique setup where point A provides a high ground and an overview of the map.
All right, we are on board with the blue team here. The blue team is,
Blue team are the defenders. So they're the ones who are trying to hold their sanctuary and oppress the attacking team.
So for us, for our purposes here, that's Team Knight in the blue, and they've come out early capturing C. But here we see the front. The battle's happening there.
Yep, so you mentioned the front. Key to the front is a type of hero that you choose to go into battle with. Certain heroes have a preference due to their range and their weapon to be in the front. You know, it's like fighting a lot of little soldiers. One-on-one, they won't do much, but a group of 10 one-year-olds can really do some damage after a while.
All right, it looks like this raider knows a thing or two.
So here we have a 2-on-1, but those of you may have noticed that there's environmental hazards that you can use to your advantage to try to help yourself in an outnumbered situation.
Just ran by one of my favorites there, the spike wall.
So there's an example of the raider stun. What that does is it takes almost all of the HUD or the UI off of your opponent's screen, making it harder for them to read which direction you're going to be attacking from. Here you can see another example of the environment being a threat. In this specific zone, the trapdoors open throughout the battle, making it more and more dangerous to be in this zone. But at the same time, we want you to be there for points.
We had quite a fight there, and now the raider has just popped a revenge.
So there we see the importance of the execution. That enemy can no longer be revived and has to wait out the respawn time, putting his team at a disadvantage.
Team Knight with a staunch defense of point C, but Team Samurai with the point lead currently.
Yeah, so right now, all three capture zones are in play. As you can see, there's only about 100 points difference. One of the keys to being a hero is that all-out offense often isn't the best way to proceed. Sometimes defense can be your best key to a productive offense.
Ooh, there's that spike wall.
Yeah, so somebody was taken into the spikes by a heavy attack. You really have to be aware of your surroundings.
That was a nice kill by defender number 4.
So here we can see one of the defenders, a raider, going to capture point A. Point A only has 2 paths to which it can be approached. Both of the bridges, and it also gives you the high ground to assess the front and the status of zone C, giving updates and feedback to your teammate throughout the match. As you can see, Team Samurai still have about 150 point buffer, but that can easily change when one or two capture zones come into play.
And there we see it happen right now. The capture zone switches, and now Team Knight has a slight point advantage, holding down 2 points.
Yeah, so we have 2 capture zones fully controlled with point C in flux. So communication on both sides should be to support friendlies at C, but there it goes back to the attacker.
There we see Fairlight Excalibur, man versus game, and munition, and Cobalt Streak on Team Samurai, currently trailing. And we've got a hot pursuit in action.
Yeah, that happens often, and that's a key to melee-based combat. It's all about range, reading spaces in the environment, and taking advantage of your character, not just their weapons, but their movement ability. Dodging, evading, blocking, and attacking.
Nice kill there by Team Samurai and Munition.
So here is a spectator cam. This player can move around the map and give feedback to their team while they're waiting to respawn.
Ooh, Gassy Mexican with a nice throw there.
If Gassy Mexican was smart, he'd get closer to the fire and try to use the environment to his advantage. Fire, spikes, drops, anything in the game world that looks dangerous, for the most part it is. So another thing that I wanted to point out, you'll see in the bottom left hand of the screen right now with this Raider in particular, we've got a skull with soldiers in front of it. This is a feat, and you gain feats by increasing your renown, by doing certain play styles and certain elements during a match. So right now this Raider gets double the reward for killing soldiers. That puts the emphasis on going front and taking advantage of the feat and the character loadout.
We saw one of those feats in the Dominion breakdown video we watched earlier, and now a lopsided fight does not go Team Samurai's way, and a brutal decapitation by Team Knight.
So we had almost all four of the defenders in the lane, in the front, clearing it out, and now they've got pretty much all 3 points, so they're away from putting the attackers in a break. 170 points away. So as you can see with the Raiders, unbridled rage, he's got no concern about defense. He's on the all-out offense, swinging that axe and taking fools down.
And the blue team very close to pushing over that 1,000 point barrier and pushing the orange team into breaking.
Here we can see that the attackers have left A uncontested, meaning it's an easy capture for the defenders, and then they can move. Oh, spoke a little too soon. So here we see a two-on-one fight. This is where space and environment gets key. A lot of our community feedback was, hey, it's really hard for us to work in an outnumbered environment, and as you can see there, it is easy to be killed, but we've been working really hard to implement features to support outnumbered fights. We'll talk about those in the preceding matches.
There are some ways to tip the scales, but then there are also sometimes you end up with a sword in your shoulder blade. Yeah.
So here we have Zone A being boosted. Not only do they have 100 points from it, they tick over an extra 2 points a second to stay with their team and help them meet the 1,000-point threshold to push the enemies into breaking.
That was Tangent Gaming holding down that elevated point over there. Now we'll switch back over and see a nice kill there by Team Knight and Co. Carnage.
So here you'll see the feedback on screen. That cross meant if there wasn't a threat to the attacker, they could stop and revive a friendly, bring them right back into battle and skip the respawn time.
Could have used another buddy right about then, but he's making his escape.
They're never there when you need them, eh? So you can see here, everything revolves around the art of battle. That is the stance in which your hero is in. It depicts where you block and where you attack. But here we have our first round of breaking.
And Team Samurai pushing back to capture that point.
The attackers need to be smart here. If they lose capture zone C, all of the attackers will respawn. However, none of them are dead, so it's not a risk at this time.
We just caught a glimpse there of this big battering ram that's on the field starting to swing. Really just adding to the whole ambiance of this battle.
Yeah, well that's it, man. It's based around the siege, and the siege isn't just killing the enemy forces or opposing forces. It's about breaching their sanctuary, their place of safety.
Got a fierce 2-on-2 here.
Yeah, so this is where collaboration is key. You go 2-on-1 and get attacked from behind. So here we have double breaking. Both teams are above the 1,000-point threshold. And now we can see it's a 4-on-2. If the defenders can hold all their zones and finish out the last two attackers, this match will be in theirs to win. So now it's an all-out manhunt.
Well, is that the last remaining member of Team Samurai running around there?
Well, he's gonna go.
Going for the revive!
So this is where communication is key. All four of them chasing the target isn't a good idea. You got to think about the setup and the space and find a way to cut them off and really get them in the corner. There you go. Here comes some strategy. Obviously, we're going for the revive here. You can see some panicked faces behind us, some shouting.
Looks like that's Lil Renene frantically trying to stay alive. She's got the entirety of the enemy team after her.
And there you have it. Another point that was mentioned was the fact that it was kind of a rat race at the end of it. That's another point. Even though there's 4-on-1, communication was still key. So here we go for match 2. So here we have the Warden going right into the front. This is almost a bread and butter for this character. He can take out a lot of soldiers and really push his team to win the front off the bat. Oh, what a dodge. Well played, but you didn't get far enough. So here you can see the soldiers do play in the battle and they make a big difference in the fights. You can use them as a navigation tool or deterrent against the enemies. Here we have a 2-on-2 in zone C. This is the zone closest to the attacker's spawn. So if the defenders take this, they're really going on the offensive and saying, we're going to win this battle.
All right, just a quick clarification for those of you folks who are watching at home. We've actually got Team Samurai, the victors of the first match, in orange this time around. They're the attackers. They're in blue this time around. It says orange on the screen. They're actually blue. And Team Knight are the defenders in orange. Defenders in blue.
See, so there we had Raider trying to run.
I just confused everything even more. Oh. Let me just iron it out, Jeff. Team Samurai is blue. Team Knight is orange.
We'll go with that. Team Knight is the blue, and Team Samurai are the orange.
I peeked at their screens, and these guys are playing on the blue side.
Either way, we'll go with attacker defender. So here we have it. The defenders are currently winning the battle.
And they've got those 2 points. And now we watch a Raider trying to make a move on one of those points.
So while we watch these guys get used to the art of battle and the intricacies of each hero, those of you out at home watching with a keen eye will notice this is no longer a samurai map. Here we are in one of the knight maps. You'll notice a difference right away. The infrastructure, the size, the epic structures that they build, and the setup of the map is completely different.
And we're gonna see Team Blue going for those revives, having another player right back on the field with you, as anyone who's played a multiplayer competitive game with reviving knows, so powerful.
Yeah, man, the ability to skip respawn really helps you make a difference. But on the flip side of that, we wanted a way for you to ensure that that couldn't happen and that a hero that you fell has to sit through the respawn. That's where execution becomes important. Because both on revive and on the execution, you're initiating an animation that leaves you open to attack. So you really have to consider whether you want to follow through. Executing an enemy not only means they have to respawn, they take on a penalty, and it gives you a health buff or a health regen. So there's a benefit and a cost to everything.
The crowd really seems to like that knock him to the ground, knee him in the face move.
Yeah, the stun definitely has, you know, its benefits, but when you're in a group fight, do you really want to initiate that, or do you want to use the space and wait for support? So here we have a female Raider doing her part in the lane, clearing through the soldiers, really working to push the front on behalf of the defenders. So that's key. All three of these heroes that we're seeing today are Vanguard, as I said, kind of like the all-rounders. And all three heroes in all three factions are available in the male and female loadout variety. So you can really choose a hero and customize it to who you want to be in the battlefield.
And even here we see two male raiders facing off, but they've got a different look to them. There is deep customization in terms of what your character's armor looks like. What sort of coloration and patterns you've got on there, the works.
Yeah, we work really hard. Our art director does a lot of work in ensuring that there's visual variety. As you can see, there's a decapitation. But the thing with the visual loadouts is that really you can make yourself prominent. So when the opposing team sees you coming, they know what they're in for. They can run and hide, group up, or really try to step up and take you one-on-one. So there is an example of the Kensai level 3 feat, the smoke bomb. That is a tool that allows you to evade outnumber fights or really just blur the battlefield for the opponent. See, so the Kensai right now is going into a part of the map that is narrow, that'll limit his opponents to attacking front on, keeping it one on one, even though he's outnumbered in a 3-on-1 fight.
Saw a little collision there on the ladder. The ladders are not, you know, they are part of the battleground. You know, just because you're on a ladder doesn't mean someone's not coming to get you.
No, that is true. Ladders often provide alternate routes to high ground, but one of the keys to being around high ground and ledges are not only can you be thrown off the ledges, but enemies can attack from above, giving them a single hit kill, or as we like to call it, death from above. So you always have to be aware of your surroundings, both immediately, but also vertically.
Here we see the blue team, Team Samurai, pushing that center point, claiming the front.
And as you mentioned before in the last map, this is similar in Dominion mode. You're trying to breach or save your sanctuary, so we have the battering ram in the middle of the front. So here we can see that the attackers own capture zone C, so while they sit in the zone, they get a health regen. It really pushes the idea of strategy and communication. We didn't want a roving horde of four heroes being able to win a match, so we strongly listened to the community feedback and came up with tweaks that would promote communication and collaboration on the battlefield, leveraging the spaces in the area.
Looks like this raider has activated one of his feats. Just as the team goes into breaking.
Yep, so here we go. It looks like they'll be able to rally immediately if they can capture Zone C. But it's all about not just capturing zones, but holding them so you keep those points out of play. Zones A, B, and C are all worth 100 points when they belong to your team. But as soon as you lose them, the points go to the other team. So those are what we've coined as soft points. They're yours while you have the zone, but they can always be taken away. As opposed to hard points. Hard points are earned by killing heroes or boosting capture zones. Those points can never be taken away from your team. So here we are once again in breaking.
And once again, Team Samurai actually in blue this round, pushing Team Knight onto the ropes.
Yeah, and then we saw an execution, so that friendly cannot be revived unless the attackers can rally out of breaking. They are looking pretty close, though. Although if they lose Zone A, it's looking pretty close to being done. So here we can see the three feats that this raider has gained. The third one is what we like to call internally Berserker. It gives you a speed and an offensive buff because he's not the fastest of heroes, but with this feat, he really becomes a formidable opponent. So the attackers are definitely doing their part to win the points back, but here we go, using the soldiers as an advantage and using his feet.
He's got his back to the fire and is he gonna catch on fire?
Here's another community feedback option. We listen to the community and outnumber fights were almost near impossible to win. So this is what we call revenge mode. It makes your attacks uninterruptible and it gives you an offensive and defensive buff. But sometimes it's just not enough, Chris.
Certainly not, and now we've got one attacker left.
And it's pretty easy to see by the faces who it is. It's a team captain on the attacker team. So here we go. There's a couple of options for the defenders. If they see enemies that are felled, they can protect the bodies to prevent revive.
There was a sprint attack that ended it, Chris.
There it is, and that is another win for Team Samurai.
So as the defenders won, they're now burning the battering ram. They held off the attack.
And here we are on the Viking homeland, it seems.
Yeah, here we have Riverford, the Viking homeland of Valkenheim. It's snowy, it's brute, it's raw. They work with the landscape and they make what they need to meet their needs. And that's about it. So here we have a similar setup to Overwatch, where we can see Zone A looks out over the entire map. Controlling this zone can really give you the upper hand in controlling the battle.
Again, for those of you watching at home, just to keep track of which color is which, just flip those names. And we got a roar from the crowd here after that ring out.
Yeah, so there we had a Raider use his throw ability to straight away take an enemy out of the capture zone and then go support a friendly and win the duel. This map is very much about using nature, so you'll see a lot of drops, a lot of ledges, and you really need to pay attention to the environment.
And that brutal execution was the handiwork of Fairlight Excalibur, working those stuns and working that unblockable combo.
Yeah, it's very much the key to that character. The unblockable combo, while it's not unblockable, it can be dodged, but at the same time, you need to be aware of what's around you and who's around you. Are you able to dodge? Where should you dodge? Is it making it riskier for you dodging close to a ledge? Should you just take the hit and focus on the defense? So we spoke before about feats. So all of the Vanguards, while they're tied to a faction and they're unique in their own way, Vanguards in general have three main kind of preferences to allow you to level up your renown and unlock your feats. And those are, in a nutshell, getting capture zones. Getting to a zone and capturing it for your team, that'll give you renown points. There's also killing soldiers and reviving friendly. So keeping a thought or an eye on those three things will help you level up, gain renown, and have your feats to make a difference in the battle.
And we've got a lot of the teams gathered here on point A, battling it out. Still early in the match, so we're not seeing those level 2, level 3 feats yet, but certainly people making progress towards bringing those extra abilities into the fray.
Yeah, and another thing that we really haven't spoken about too much, but we just saw it there, is the need to control your stamina. The green bar underneath your health is your stamina. It tells you how much gas you have in the tank. If you're constantly dodging, you're going to run out of breath and be a really easy opponent to take out. Not only does stamina affect your mobility, it also means you're unable to put any chains together, which makes you much weaker as an offensive force.
Nice kill there by Tangent Gaming.
So overall, we haven't really been talking too much about the heroes, but throughout all three matches so far, we've had a good spread, Chris. We've had the Warden, both male and female. We've had the Raider and the Kensei. And I haven't noticed too much of a strategy yet with their loadouts, but we'll see how this game plays out, and maybe it'll affect how they play match 4 if we make it to that point. But right now, it's looking pretty good.
It looks like Team Knight has all 3 points captured. Again, just switch those colors, folks, and you'll be in tune with the action here.
So you can see right now the Raider, the first feat is a passive feat, meaning it's always active. Every soldier he kills gives him a health buff, but it also helps him gain further renown. So he's unlocked a morale booster, the second feat. The third is Berserker, and he's well on the way to the fourth feat. So on the flip side of that, here we have the Knight, also working in the lane, because killing soldiers is a good way to increase your renown.
That pick up and carry move just does not get old. I love it.
Yeah, so here we have the opportunity to use high ground to take out the attacker in the capture zone, but I guess it wasn't needed.
that medieval chiropractor.
A Nodashi down the spinal, kind of take care of you.
You'll be aligned, all right.
So here we have it again. You can see two attackers not on a capture zone and focusing a two-on-one, but that didn't work to their advantage. Now it's flipped completely into a two-on-one in their disadvantage. So you really have to work to prioritize your threats. Last but not least, it's objective-based. The capture zones are key to winning the round. So we're pretty much back at honors even, so let's see how this plays out with 400 points, give or take, to put the other team into breaking.
This is one of those perilous points where you do have the chance to get knocked to a lower ground and then hit from above. You do have the chance to get thrown off the ledge, or you have the chance to just get a good old-fashioned two-on-one.
Yeah, sometimes the sword's the best way to go, man. So here's a view of the map from the attacker side. Obviously, they're starting from outside of the sanctuary. They've reached the first gate, but they're still really trying to make it into the courtyard and the main structure of this Viking facility. Oh, he was so close, but just not close enough, Chris.
Kensei is going to make a nice saving roll to get back into more solid ground. Gotta work that block, though, because that big Viking axe coming down.
So now if this raider waits out his time, he can capture the zone and use this zone to regen his health and not die. Stay in the battle and work with his teammates.
Oh! Sent to the bottom.
The extra health really made no difference there, Chris. So here you can see three attackers. They're very much deciding to work as a group. Whether it works out point-wise, we'll wait and see. Right now they have two of the capture zones, but A is in flux and could quickly change.
Looks like we were gonna maybe see an execution there, but now we are involved in a fierce battle here, and you see that the Raider attacking has all 4 feet at the ready.
Yeah, and here we see, oh, the Kensei had feet.
Didn't need the feet to put him onto the spikes, though.
So, I don't want to sound like I'm repeating a lot, but Emil came out and we spoke about working with the community. One thing is now when you die, you do not lose your renown or your feet. So even if you aren't the best player on your team, by the end of the match, you could have full renown and have that level 4 feet to really make a difference. We really want it to be a balanced playing field. So here we have it. For the first time, the attackers have put the defenders into breaking. Can they hold it off? This attacker actually has a fourth level feat, which is a healing banner, which he can place and heal any of his friendlies within a certain radius.
One can easily see how that would change the tide of an engagement. Let's see if we see it in action.
Okay, so we've got two duels going on at A. And it's gone from 3-on-2 to 2-on-1 by the looks of all the crosses on the screen.
And it's the blue team. Yeah. Team Samurai trying to rally back. Looks like we've got Cobalt Streak there as the Raider.
Ooh.
And the orange Team Knight goes down. The defenders rally.
Yeah, so the defenders rally there, but they're quickly back in breaking because instead of focusing on the capture zones, while they had the hero advantage, they all honed in on one hero, meaning that they didn't take those soft points back and bring them back on their side. Capture zones are all about soft points. Once you have them, you have to retain them. Otherwise, they're always in play. There we see it. So we have double breaking, but it's a 4-on-2. And all the soft points are still in play because they're only 50 to 20 points above the 1,000 point threshold, Chris.
So that certainly sifted the fate for Team Orange, no longer breaking. But nope. The blue team.
Team Orange heeded the advice. They saw that there was a capture zone not being contested, A, and they went and took it. Now, essentially, there's no choice. Well played. There's no choice for the defenders to go out of breaking because there's only 300 points, soft points in play, and even if they lose them, they're still above a 1,000 point threshold.
And this is the blue team. Team Samurai on the ropes. Looks like Fairlight Excalibur, the last remaining Samurai, trying to make a run here, trying to stay alive.
There was a death from above. But there you see communication, Chris. They took all four escape points and really tried to tie him down.
They are running him down. Everyone chasing him with the ladder, but he came back down and knocked one of them to the ground. He's on the point. He's on the ropes.
So there you have it.
And there it is. Looks like all those cheers did Team Knight well as they...
All top, light, heavy. You know, there's a lot of variation, and that really changes the setup. But Chris, it looks like we're back in game, so should we get to it? We're back here at the Samurai theme map in the mire. As you can see, it's raining. And right off the bat, the attackers are going to push through the lane by the looks of it.
Is it just me, or does that carry get longer every time we see it?
It all depends about where they are, but yeah, it definitely has some range.
Okay, and again, we've got the color swapped, so Team Knight is in orange, Team Samurai in blue, and one of those nasty Nodachi executions right there.
Yeah, so executions progress as you progress as a hero and increase your renown, but that was a variation of it, and they're all pretty badass, and they also play into the gameplay, like we said. That hero can no longer be revived, and now he's free to go use his enormous Nodachi to make a difference in the front.
You ever feel bad for those foot soldiers facing off against the Nodachi, the Raider Axe, and all that?
Yeah, they really have no choice, and not just that, the presence of these heroes in the front really boosts the morale of their soldiers, who will really go on the offensive and come like a tide.
Speaking from experience, you can focus on an enemy hero inside that front, but if they've got a bunch of their warrior minions around them, that's going to really cause a problem for you in terms of mobility, in terms of chipping away at your health. It definitely is something to contend with.
Yeah, man, it's like trying to have a fight surrounded by 10 5-year-olds. One-on-one, they don't do much, man, but a group of them will slowly wear you down. So not only do they affect your health, but like you said, your navigation. And up against someone like the Kensei, you need to be aware of your surroundings. So they've definitely taken a focus onto the decapitations or executions. Thanks for that, Chris. So they're really going for a focus of taking out the heroes, not allowing them to be revived, because don't forget, that gives their friendly renown and helps them level up. So that's taken one of their core progressions away from them throughout the match. So here we're boosting the zone, we're getting hard points, and we're generating our health. Seems like the attackers are definitely trying to egg the defenders away from the zone so they can get them in duels and hopefully, you know, take them one-on-one. We'll see how that plays out, though, because the defenders are definitely managing the battlefield better right now.
Nice kill there by Cobalt Streak.
Here we have the crowd getting into it. Come on, guys, you can cheer them on. Don't be shy.
Oof. Every time.
So here you can see, man, the defenders have all three capture zones and they're very much going on the offensive. This is the first bridge outside of the attacker zone, so we're right on their doorstep.
And that is that gut-slicing Kensei execution by Team Samurai. Really putting Team Knight on their back foot here with all 3 points.
Yeah, so here you can see this Kensei is at a key navigation point. He was controlling the bridge. It was the only real access point to Zone A for the attackers. Although as soon as I mentioned it, they gave it up, so we'll wait and see what happens.
That's how quickly the battlefield shifts, Spicer.
So here we are back in the lane. We've got a 3-on-1, but you can see the attacker's very much using his soldiers to help with navigation and defense.
Tangent Gaming here with two of his feats. Ooh, a nice dodge there of that powerful strike coming in by the Kensei.
And the key here is even though you... Oh, so there's revenge. That's what I was talking about, your ability to get the upper hand in the fight that you're not doing so well in. So now his attacks are uninterruptible. He's got an offensive and defensive buff.
Some great blocking there by the Kensei. They are both on the ropes here. Let's hear it, folks. Who's going to come out on top in this one-on-one duel? It's the Kensei.
The Kensei is very much a samurai. It's about finesse, movement, and fluidity. You saw their great use of the chains going from left, right, top. That top is actually unblockable. So the only choice is to dodge. But as you saw, they didn't do it in time, and they fell pretty quickly. So now it looks like the attackers are taking the group approach, and hopefully as a team they can last a little longer and get some zones back.
Well, I don't know. This team night member is heading over to B to try to tip the scales here.
So once again, you can see the passive feat. Every soldier that this warden kills, they're getting a +1 hard point and a health regen. Here's a quick shot of the scoreboard. So the defenders have 100 points that they own due to Zone C, but irrelevant to that, they're almost at 800 hard points. So they're a couple kills away from pushing the attackers into breaking.
And there it is. And a quick rally by Team Knight to stay in the game.
So you'll notice now at this capture zone, the additional trapdoors have opened, so it's a much smaller fight space, and it's that much more dangerous, especially when you're against a knight with the range of that carry throw. So that's one attacker down, there's three left, and they better move quickly to get those zones if they want to bring their friendly back, Chris.
We're watching Fairlight Excalibur here. Gonna make a move to try to take this back. It's a 2-on-2. It's close to the edge, manages to get a little space, but he is in the bin, courtesy of Co-Carnage.
So there we go, we're back into breaking again.
And that is Team Knight in orange breaking, Team Blue Samurai trying to push their advantage.
So let's see what strategy we're going to go for with the attackers here, Chris. We see one running back to spawn. His friendlies are currently not on the map. So it looks like they're down either in the lane or near A. Are they going to group up or are they going to go for the soft points of the capture zone?
And this is Lil Renene finding herself in a tight spot. Once again, pursued. Just dodges that strike everywhere she turns. There's a samurai waiting for her, but now her teammate comes to help alleviate things, and it's...
Oh.
Oh, no!
There you have a friendly taking a friend into the pit, guys. You gotta be aware of what's going on, but it shows you just how quickly it can change. So we're down to one. We're over 1,300 points. This is the last stand for the attackers, and there you have it, guys.
That is it. Team Samurai, your victors here.
Every army needs warriors whose specialty is victory. Kensei, sword saints, the guardians of our people. Every great ruler since the fall has trained as a sword saint. Everyone. And they are formidable. The Nodachi was long thought to be too large for use in real war. They proved them wrong. Their armor is the strongest of our people. As is their will.
Sometimes, a Viking is born who carries the spark of gods. Raiders, we call them. It is a name that can summon armies. Ruthless, fearless, made for battle. The Dane Axe was the mightiest weapon of our ancestors. They wield it without mercy. The moment of a Viking's death is chosen by fate. So what use have they of armor? Or of fear?
The Wardens. Members of an ancient order, fallen into dust. Sworn to defend the weak, masters of the longsword. Their origins lost to history, still they fight for what is right. Driven by duty, devoted to their people. Join their order.
Hey folks, Chris Waters here with Stefan Cardin, the producer on For Honor. Stefan, it's Gamescom time and you are showing For Honor in a really big way.
Yeah, really exciting time. You know, last E3, we surprised people with our campaign, and now it's time to get back to the root of the franchise, which is multiplayer.
Multiplayer, and specifically today we started with Dominion, that 4v4 mode with AI enemies mixing it up in the middle and a bunch of different capture points. Let's talk about how you guys have improved this mode since we last saw it.
You know, we adjust a few things like the control points, but the big things that we're bringing in this year, it's the impact of new heroes on the battlefield. So we announced for the first time our 12 heroes that will be at launch for the players. And what people realize or will realize if you didn't have the chance to play is that each of them play completely differently, right? You have different abilities, different combos, specific set of animation for each of those characters. And you need to master that weapon and his advantages and his disadvantage to be efficient on the battlefield.
It's not just one knight, one Viking, one samurai. I mean, you've got samurais wielding huge cudgels. You've got Vikings darting around with axes. There are sort of different archetypes within each faction to give players, you know, a different way to attack, a different speeds to attack, and play different roles during combat.
Exactly, and we realized quickly that they were falling into one of those four categories, right? We have the assassins, the very fast one. You have the other one who are more tanks on the battlefield that we call the heavy. You have the kind of hybrid character, which is mixing some of the attribute of those category. And you have the vanguard, which is the jack of all trades, right?
And they look so distinct because And they have to, because if I'm rolling up and I'm fighting a heavy, I need to know I can't afford to take a hit from that heavy, because it's gonna lay my health real low.
Yeah, but against AV, you need the most difficult part is to find the opening on those characters. They usually have shield, they protect themselves very well. They are extremely efficient in the middle of the lanes with the minions. Very difficult to move out the control points. So you really need to strategize, and what is fun is because you can mismatch those 12 characters in each of the team. Each match feels different because you need to adapt to not just the strategy of the other team, but also their roosters.
Absolutely.
And on top of the sort of fearsome looking masks and just these incredible armors that they have, you can customize it yourself to get your own look.
Yeah, very quickly players will realize that each of those 12 characters are just templates. Because you can customize everything about them. You can customize their appearance, their gender, their skin tone. You could put tattoos, emblems on your armors. You can change the blade of your weapon, the hilt, the helmet. Everything is customizable, and you have hundreds of options out there to create your own version of that character.
All right, so Dominion mode, there's a few other things in here that I want to talk about, because one of the things players were experiencing was, if there's four heroes running around the battlefield plus all these AI, you can maybe get overwhelmed pretty quickly if the other team is working in coordination, or if show up at a capture point and lo and behold, there's a few more of them than there are of you.
Exactly. It's not the best players who win in Dominion. Team play, communication is what makes the difference at the end. We run different tournaments internally, and it's always the same thing. The teams that took time to coordinate themselves and strategize well, and more importantly, adapt on the fly on the strategy of the other teams, usually win the match.
Yeah, I mean, if you've got a teammate around who can revive you in the modes that permit reviving, that's huge. And also, the new revenge mechanic you guys have worked in and revamped for working on those lopsided situations to make it a little more viable. Let's talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, but one of the big complaints we received, not just when we announced, but when we went live, was that, when I fight against multiple enemies, it becomes difficult to, I feel overwhelmed.
It's really hard, yeah.
Yeah, I feel like I don't have enough tools. So that was a huge challenge, right? We tried many things, we prototyped a lot, and we came up with that revenge system. So if you manage well against multiple enemies and you're able to survive, you're filling up a gauge, and at some point you can trigger the revenge mode. So you become kind of in a fury mode and you start being unblockable, and you're able to change the momentum of the fight and take advantage of a 2v1 situation. And I think I saw you play against two guys and killing them. The feeling,
Satisfying to just rage out, because I was, you go from being like, this is real bad for me, I need something to tip the scales, and then you bust that up. It just is really empowering.
Oh no, it's crazy. And when we stumble on that on the production floor, we said, okay, I think we have something to solve that issue.
Stefan, anything else at the Gamescom sort of showing of For Honor that you think folks are going to be really interested in that you want to highlight?
But to me, it's really, we heard for several months, hey guys, do you only have three characters in this game? No, we don't have three characters in the game. We have 12 characters that are going to be fully customizable, from the appearance to the armors to the weapons. So I think people will be pleased to see how much a difference a new character can bring on the battlefield.
I can't wait to get back into that customization. I mean, I was fiddling around with it a little bit, and there were just so many cool like armor pieces and gauntlets and shoulders and all this stuff that you could customize and just make a really cool looking warrior. So folks want to make one for themselves, tell them when For Honor is coming out.
Yeah, you need to be ready. Next Valentine, it won't be about love and flowers. It will be
The world fears us. We are the favored of the gods. We plunder new lands. We raid and we grow strong. We live for battle, ready to die in glory.
Cast away from our land, we are rebuilding. Our hearts are strong, our devotion absolute, and our skill is beyond question. We will be remembered.
We are the guardians of our people. we stand strong against all invaders. Duty is our shield, order our weapon. When we defend the weak, we are immortal. Relax, my beloved, don't worry for me. Don't shed a tear for me, always be near for me. You know these walls, they may fall down. They're high, high, and you'd imagine me too. That raider reminded us of who we are. We would raid, but not Apollyon. Not yet. But they knew we were coming. Of that fortress hadn't worked for a century. All we had to do was get through them. Was the only way forward.
Get over here! Call the rope launchers!
Ropes! Grapples here!
Climb!
made it to the top. One would be enough. Got us inside that fort.
Now we have them.
My fortress is lost. My soldiers slaughtered. Soon, I will join them. You open the gate. Now, you will pay! Showed us what Viking fury could do. The Great Raid, they would call it. And it had begun.
Hey gang, my name is Jeff Spicer. I'm a production manager on For Honor, and I'm here today with
For
our...
This game puts you on the battlefield with three great warrior legacies.
Playing Dominion mode, so this is 4v4, two teams both trying to dominate the battlefield by way of three strategic control zones.
So here we are following my character, a knight, with my knight brothers and sisters. Our immediate priority was to gain control of capture zone A. We plan on doing that by pushing the attacking front back and out of the zone.
Speaking of pushing people out of the zone, check this out. Boom.
Just because you have Zone C, though, doesn't mean you're controlling the battlefield.
Right here is a good showcase for the innovative control scheme that we call the Art of Battle. The system gives you a really huge degree of control over your weapon via the right stick. You can see here that you're choosing which side to attack or block.
The key component to the Art of Battle is giving you, the fighter, control over both your attack and defense by tying it directly to the right stick. Now that I've completely annihilated the attackers at Zone C, let's take an overall look at the battle.
Alright, so looking out over the map, you can see that my team, the attacking team, has just captured the central zone at Zone A, and also my teammates are pushing a little further and capturing Zone B.
That is correct. At that point in the battle, the attackers were controlling two-thirds of the battlefield, so around that time, I decided that my services could probably be used elsewhere. Thankfully, Lady Anne was ready, so we pair up and see if we can do some damage. Isn't this the one?
Oh, no. Yeah, I remember this fight. It was a pretty good fight, but I think I actually lose this. Yeah, I do lose this one.
Yeah, you do lose here. I'm pretty sure you don't just lose the fight, though. You lose your head, eh, bud?
Yeah. All right, after that embarrassing little incident, here we are over in the attacking team side of the map. I'm playing as the Samurai Assassin. We went forward in time a little bit. You can see the score has changed. Both teams are over 1,000, which means that both teams are breaking the enemy team, preventing them from respawning. That's why you see little icons and player names at the side of the screen. So I see somebody all alone over there, and I'm gonna go eliminate him. My Samurai Assassin doesn't have the greatest defense, but I have really good offensive capabilities and fast, lethal strikes. I do love these high spots in the map. This is useful for me trying to find my next target.
And like Jeff said, in breaking, the team fully eliminated loses a battle. This increases the importance of the surviving heroes on the battlefield. Using this and my usual strategy, I decide to go pair up with Lady Anne.
Now, this narrow bridge was a good setup for me to try and use my arrow storm, my samurai feet, to kind of take out at least one of you, but at least it made you separate.
And gave Lady Anne the opportunity to completely fail the Brotherhood.
I like how this next part goes.
You may win this battle.
Ha!